Well, there's got to be a peak somewhere along the week. I just say it's the peak of the week. Yeah. Wednesday night is the peak, amen?
Amen.
Let me get my notes. What's that commercial for? Where the guy with the camel's walking around the office? You know what that is?
Geico.
Oh, for Geico, there you go, perfect. Yeah, that's for Geico. You know, it's funny, actually, I wasn't even connecting the dots there, but, you know, it's amazing how if you believe in something or if you remember, you know, you're reminded of something, you can usually, you know, draw that association. And I was thinking today of, just some of the companies. So I grabbed the top 10 slogans for recognizable companies. So if you hear the slogan, you'll then recognize the company. And if there's the recognition, then you'll purchase that product. And over time, what happens, if you believe in the slogan, then they've got you. I mean, you're what they consider a loyal consumer. And that's how companies usually market their products. They'll try and find out the right tagline that'll connect the particular brand. And again, once you get the recognition, they try and drive brand loyalty. If I drive brand loyalty, then I sell more of my products and make more money, and the company goes round and round and round, right? So I thought we'd have a little fun tonight, if that's all right. And I have the top 10 recognizable slogans. So I'm going to give you the slogan, and then hopefully you're going to give me the company that it represents. Now, I don't know if these are the official rankings or not, but these are the top 10 that I Googled. So the first one, a diamond is forever.
Zales.
Zales, close, Mike.
Jerry.
It's actually the beers. The beers, but a diamond is forever. But you recognize it, right? It's jewelry, right? A diamond is forever. This one should be pretty easy, I think. Got Milk. Yeah. Recognizable. Talk about actually that comes from the Dairy Association. Right? The Dairy Association. Got Milk. This is an old one. I remember this one growing up. So probably the younger kids are not going to recognize this one. But where's the beef? Yeah. Wendy's. Yeah. Remember that old lady, where's the beef? Now this one here, I debated it, but I said, nah, you know what, because it might not be that recognizable, we'll see what happens. Great taste, less filling.
It's beer.
It's beer, but we don't know it. Thank God! Yay! It's actually Miller Lite. It is in the top 10. This one's real good. Don't leave home without it. Bingo, American Express, yeah. Now, some of these you could associate with also the Word of God or Christ, right? Don't leave home without it, amen. Or even Got Milk, right? Got Milk.
Great taste, more filling.
Great, absolutely great taste, more filling. Yes, yeah, these are all good. They all work. Melts in your mouth, not in your hands.
Yeah.
You're in good hands.
All set.
These are all very good. I think these might be title messages. We try harder.
Avis.
Avis, thank you. Yeah, you guys are probably on a lot of Avis. We try harder, Avis. This is an oldie but a goodie, Dad, so I'm going to expect you to shout out on this one. Good to the last drop. Yeah. And then actually the one that is the most recognizable and has transcended all age groups, and I'm not surprised, Just Do It. It's the most recognizable slogan in the world. Just Do It, right? And of course that is Nike. And which we're gonna talk about that tonight, which is why we landed there, because Nike is the Greek word for, anybody? Yeah, victory, victory. And so tonight we are going to talk a little bit about victory. And so I thought we'd just keep with the traditional Bible study format on Wednesday. So I do have some verses that I'd like to maybe open up tonight. So you have them. Does everybody have notes, by the way, everybody? Okay, very good. So maybe Pastor Phil, if we could start with you, if you could just read for us Matthew 5, 18 and 19.
Verily I
I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass away, not one jot or tittle shall in no wise pass from the law, till all be fulfilled. Whoever therefore shall break one of the least of these commandments, and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven.
Yeah, amen. So this is a very familiar passage, of course, and this is really on the front end of essentially the Sermon on the Mount, which is, you know, I'm sure we'd all agree is probably the greatest sermon that was ever preached since Jesus Christ preached that message. And we have talked about this in the past as well, but what jumped out at me when I was reading it this week was that whosoever shall do and teach, they shall be called great in the kingdom. But you have to do it first before you can teach it. And I thought of Nike, just do it. When you essentially have the proper victory, you just do it. And of course, you know, we talk about until heaven and pass, not one jot or one tittle will pass. And what it's saying there, again, what we talked about, you got to get past that way of thinking. It's not that heaven's going away and earth's going away. No, heaven and earth are not going anywhere. Heaven will always be, I believe, earth. It says actually in Psalms and in Proverbs that it remains. So what we're talking about is we got to get past that way of thinking. Because if I think that I don't have everything, or I got to do something to attain heaven, or I have to do something to get close to God, then I won't get past some very basic elementary thinking, some very basic and elementary, you know, beliefs of the Word of God. So I have to get past that, because then he says, what happens? Well, then you won't fulfill this. You won't fulfill every jot and tittle, which again is if we're talking about the law. Now again, the law is just a precursor. Which we have, you know, we have shared many messages on this, but it really is just a precursor. And Michael, I was thinking of it today, actually. My brother and I got to get to the gym before service today and got into a little workout. And so, those of you who know, we do work out a little bit every now and then. But anyway, we went to the gym today, and we actually started out. And we went in the gym before, we don't go in right away and pick up what's the most heaviest weight we got? Let's pick that up and start there. No, we don't start there. That would be ridiculous. So what we do is we actually go and grab the 50-pound dumbbells. We lay down on the bench and we warm up with the 50-pound dumbbells. You know, we'll do about 20, 25 reps just to get the muscle strength, get the blood going. And then once we warm up, okay, now it's time to start training. And then we grab, you know, the 90-pound dumbbells, we'll do a set. The 100-pound, we'll do a set. The 110s, we'll do a set. And the 120s. We don't start with the 120s, but the 50s get us to the 120s. You see, so there's a greater strength. Yeah, I can lift the 50s. And the purpose for the 50s, though, is to get me to the 20s. So that's the same thing with the law. Listen, that was just a precursor. Lie. Adam lies. Christ doesn't lie. Christ just speaks the truth. He just speaks the word of God. Steal. Don't be ridiculous. Adam steals. Christ just gives. These are just the 50-pound dumbbells, guys. That's the whole purpose of the Sermon on the Mount. Because then he says what? He goes on to say, listen, if someone gets a lawyer and sues you for your coat, hey, no problem. Take the tunic, too. Somebody smacks you in the face, hey, no problem, get the other side. Someone forces you and says, hey, you got to go a mile with me. No, a mile, nothing, I'm going 2 miles with you. You see, I can do the 50s. I want to get to the 120s. Jesus Christ wants us to get to the 120s. I want to get to that place where I say, hey, no problem. Yeah, I can love my enemies. I can bless those that curse me. I can pray for those that speak really nasty things about me. I can pray for them and say, their heart. They just don't know yet. So the 50 pounds were just to get us to the 120s. Pentecost, 50. 120s. And the flesh beginning of spirit. 120s.
Hey, no.
You say, why do we lift the 120s? Because we can. But that's essentially what this passage is saying. He's saying, listen, you've got to mature. You've got to get beyond this if you're going to get to the Sermon on the Mount. If you're going to get to this essentially this higher way of living, which Isaiah also talks about here. But it's just that. But we do that. And then I teach them. For years we wanted to teach them and wait for everybody else to do them. And maybe we'll do them, maybe we don't do them. Well, just do it. Because by doing it, by living that lifestyle, that will teach them. We actually don't have to speak in that. I just have to live my life just like Jesus Christ said on the Sermon on the Mount. Oh, you're suing me? What do you want, 100? Yeah, take 2. Oh my goodness, what is that? That's Sermon on the Mount. I just got past the law. I just blew right by those 50 pounders and I'm at 120 now. This is no problem for me. This is no problem for you. And so we go beyond. That's victory. That's victory. And so what do I do? You just do it. Like Nike says, just do it, man. Just do it. You have the power. He's given you the power to do that. He didn't preach that message because you thought you couldn't do it. Jesus Christ preached that message 2,000 years ago because he gave you the power to do that. And so it's my ability today. It's your ability today to live your life today. That's the victory. Listen, somebody's got to show them the way. Somebody's got to show them that you got to get beyond that so that you grow stronger, you mature. You don't stay there. Now, I don't throw away the 50s. I still need them. I warm up with them. I didn't get rid of them. I still want them. I need them. But I don't stop there. That's just a beginner. That's just a precursor to get me someplace much greater, to get you someplace much greater. That's all that was. It was just to show you the way. Amen?
Amen.
So now we're going to get towards, actually, it's really the end of the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 7. And if somebody would like to read those couple of verses there, 24 through 27 for us. So this is really coming to the close of the Sermon on the Mount. The last verse actually says that the people, the great multitudes, they were astonished. They were amazed because he did not teach like the scribes, like the law. So they were blown away. They were like, wow, man. But I love this passage here because, what is it saying here? Because there's a time where we have this temporary position in life, which is really, it's the sand. And we're not supposed to build something permanent on it because it's temporary. Because, listen, the storm's going to come. And if the house is on the sand, it's coming down. And many of us have had a house on sand. Most of us have had a house. Well, maybe not. Maybe it's just me. But if you had a house on sand, it's coming down because it's just temporary. The rock, of course, it is Jesus Christ. And it's the revelation of that. You have the awareness of Jesus Christ and where he is. See, now when the storm comes, the rains come, pound all day long. That's fine. There's no issue. The house is on the rock. But when it's on the sand, when it's on this temporary place, it's going to come down, and great will be the fall. But we're talking about, once again, it's just a temporary to bring about the eternal. It's to take away this earthly realm to bring about the heavenly realm. And that's just what this passage is saying here. But he says, listen, both here, one does and the other one doesn't. But it's got to be founded on what? The same thing that Jesus Christ told him when he talked to Peter, right? Peter, who does some say to him? Oh, as I am Moses, this and that. Yeah, but who do you say I am? You are the Christ. Flesh and blood didn't reveal this to you, Peter. And on this, on the understanding, the revelation of the Spirit of God that inside of you said, man, this is the Christ. I don't have any firm foundation for this. It's only my heart that tells me this man is Christ. On that, I can build something. Because now God has my heart. God has my awareness. And I listen to that, and I don't worry about the storm. I don't worry about the flood, and I don't worry about the rains. And now I've got a rock. My house isn't going anywhere.
Amen.
But when I don't listen to the heart, and I listen to what everybody else said, well, you're Moses, you're an Elijah, and what happens? Those are the folks, your house is going to crumble, man, because it's built on sand. It's not built on the Spirit of Christ that's inside of you, the revelation that God's going to birth inside of you. Amen? Next passage take a look at here is actually in Genesis 13, verses 14 through 16, if somebody would like to take those.
And the Lord said unto Abram, after that Lot was separated from him, lift up thine eyes, and look from the place, for thou northward, thou southward, west, eastward, and westward, for all the land which thou seest, to thee I give, to thy seed forever. And I will make thy seed as the dust of the earth, so that if a man can number the dust of the earth, so they shall seed also be numbered.
Yeah, and so what's happened here? This is the time where Abraham and Lot actually part company, right? And essentially what happens is God has now just made the covenant with what? The seed. The seed that was inside of Abraham. the seed, which of course, as we know, it is Christ. But that was the covenant. It was made then. And it should be as great as the dust. Which the dust is, and the sand, which is just the first two realms. And so that God was in it, but it wasn't, we're not staying there. Nothing's getting built on that. It's just a time of maturing. It's just a time of preparation. But I love that because it says, the Lord said this to Abraham when? After Lot separated from him. After Lot's just the flesh now. So Abraham is the spirit man, Lot's the flesh man. Once I get the flesh man out of the way, okay, let me tell you the promise that I have for you. It's not for the flesh, it's for the spirit of Christ that's inside of you. So once that's separated, once that's out of the way, okay, now let me reveal this promise to you. Because if most of you, if you look at your body, you probably have a star, it's bold or something, because it's a promise from God. Which, I mean, the whole word is a promise from God, but there are certain things that they'll highlight. But this is essentially what God's promising. He says, listen, it'll be greater than your seed. It's going to be greater than the dust. And essentially what that last passage is saying is, you can't, you know, don't measure it, don't number it. When the Bible talks about not to number things, when he told David, don't number it, you don't measure it. You don't measure the first two realms. We don't measure the dust. We don't measure the sand. Which is essentially just the first two rounds. Because that's essentially what he says here then in Genesis 32:12. And thou saidst, I will surely do good to thee, and make thy seed as the sand of the sea, which cannot be numbered for multitude. So now God just made a greater covenant with him. So now we went from dust to sand, and eventually we get where? We do get to the stars, man. You see, but the dust and the sand, we don't measure that. That doesn't get measured. That's not what we're looking at. That's not what we're judging one another on. Because God's saying, listen, I'm just maturing you guys. You're still messing around with 50-pound dumbbells. I got to get you to the 120s. You're not there yet. Eventually, you're going to get there, and you're going to be in the stars. And then you can, then what you do measure, which is when Revelation talks about the most holy place, it's Christ. Then I measure the Christ in you. You measure the Christ in me. Guess what? It's the same measurement. Same exact specs, height, length, width. It's identical for all of us. Now, that you can measure. Because there's no difference there. There's no separation there. But if I measure these other things, that creates a separation. That creates a division. And we're talking about ingathering. We're talking about tabernacles. We're talking about oneness. God wants a oneness. He wants a oneness with him and then with one another. And so until I get to the star covenant, until I realize the Christ that's inside of you and I is the same, then we create the separation. Because we're measuring dust or sand. And that's never, you're not supposed to measure that. We got to separate that. And even, what's cool too, if you think about it, even in the natural, you can touch dust, right? Anybody ever touch like a dusty TV? Sand, you can touch sand, right? Can you touch a star? No. You ever go out and look at the stars? Do they move? No. You go out, the Big Dipper is always in the same place all the time. It doesn't move. Now, every now and then you'll see one that you think is a shooting star. They're not actually shooting stars. They're actually... meteorites, they're not actual, you know, like, you don't lose, like, one of the stars out of the Big Dipper, that doesn't happen. But again, that simple truth also tells me just, again, it's the natural is a reflection of the spiritual. Because we can touch the dust, right, you know, we impact it, we can move it, the sand, we impact it, we move it, but you can't the stars. You can't touch them, you can't move them. Now, if God chooses to move those stars, he could, but we can't move them. And essentially, that's where God's looking to bring us. It's to a star covenant, because that's the true foundation. You can't move that. It's real. And bless God, you can see it. But you can't touch it and you can't move it. That's the Spirit of Christ that's inside of you and I. It's real. And yeah, we can see it. Well, we want to see it. And sometimes we don't want to see it. Instead, we see the dust and the sand. And when we see the dust and the sand, sometimes we're not happy with the dust and the sand. Anybody happy with the dust? I don't like the dust. And I don't like getting sand on me when I go to the beach. But you don't measure that. You don't number that. It's just a time for maturing. We're just talking about the dust and the sand. Somebody, if you would, read for me Numbers 24:17. Yeah, so here's, again, essentially the covenant that he's making. But I love it because he says, where's the star coming out of? Yeah, it's coming out of Jacob. Now, well, Jacob is the natural man. He's not yet Israel. The star comes out when he becomes Israel. So while we're still in this immature state, Jacob, the natural man, still measuring the dust and the sand, right? He was still arguing and, you know, conniving with his brother and, you know, doing all kinds of silly things because he just hadn't yet matured yet. He hadn't yet seen the face of God. He hadn't seen the revelation. But the Bible says that the star is coming out of Jacob, the natural man. It's coming out of him. I put it there. That's the seed. You see, and even that, when you think about a seed, you know what? Isaiah says, does the plowman plow all day long? Now, God is the plowman. He plows a seed, and then he leaves it alone. You don't keep plowing. Oh, did it grow yet? No. Tomorrow you bury it. You dig it up again. Did it grow yet? No. It's ridiculous. No, right? I mean, you don't. You plant the seed and you leave it alone. And then, you know, it's like, remember when you do those little projects you used to get the styrofoam cup when you were a kid, and you had the science projects, and you plant the seed, and, you know, and eventually you do forget about it, and then what happens? Like, 3 months later, your mom's like, get this thing out of here, this weed's growing out of it, and everything, and it's like, hey! And then you're like, oh my goodness, it grew! I did something, I put the seed there, and it grew! But it took time. The seed is Christ, the seed isn't there. The star is inside of Jacob, it's gonna come out. Just leave it alone, let it be shown. We gotta give it time to grow. The plowman plowed the seed. The seed's there. He didn't get it wrong. He didn't miss you. He didn't miss a field. Everybody got it. You just gotta give it time to mature. But then what that also tells me also, when I have a relationship or when I have folks around me or see folks around me that don't realize that, the seed is still there. It just hasn't blossomed yet. The star, it's inside of Jacob. It just didn't come out yet. It's gonna come out though. And when does it come out? Well, it came out when he wrestled with God. Because it says what happened? After he wrestled, it said that the sun rose in Peniel, the face of God. I have now seen the face of God. I now have an awareness of the Spirit of God that resides inside of me. Now, I'm no longer Jacob. I have become Israel. You've become Israel. The star has risen. No longer the natural. It's the Spirit of Christ that's inside of us. I have an awareness. And so now the promise of the star covenant. Revelation. We're not waiting for that. It's not like some day far off. No. That's already taken place. That's already taken place in you and I, amen? Yeah. And then 2 Peter, which I love this verse also, because it says, we have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto ye do well that ye take heed, as unto the light that shineth in a dark place, unto the day of dawn, and the day star arise in your hearts. The day star. The same thing that happened to Jacob. The same thing that happens to you and I. Just the Christ. Where does it arise? In your heart. Inside of you. This is not some strange phenomenon. I mean, God is a phenomenon. But he's not strange. He clearly tells you right here. It's in your heart. It's just the Christ that rises inside of you. Now you have just reached the star covenant. Amen? So I'd like to actually go back to our story we talked about on Sunday. Remember we talked about the Shunammite woman and Elisha? Remember we talked about the four pieces of furniture? Can anybody tell me the four pieces of furniture? Yeah. Stool. I'm sorry, a candle, stool. Bed.
Table.
Big Mike. Yeah. Four pieces of furniture, which are essentially four pieces of furniture that we have, right? Two of them are internal, two of them become external. Well, remember that woman's son had died. And when we last left her on Sunday, we were talking, she was at the feet of Elisha. And Elisha says, okay, go. And what happens? Well, Elisha goes to the Shunammite woman's home and goes upstairs. So that's where we're picking it up. So somebody, if you wouldn't mind, read for me 2 Kings 4, verse 34.
And he went up and lay upon the child, put his mouth upon his mouth, and his eyes upon his eyes, and his hands upon his hands. And he stretched himself upon the child, and the flesh of the child waxed warm. Then he returned and walked in the house to and fro, and went up and stretched himself upon him. And the child sneezed seven times, and the child opened his eyes.
Amen. The child opened his eyes. Don't you find it interesting that he sneezed seven times? I do.
Yeah.
And we just talked about the dust. So what do you think he's doing, sneezing? He's just getting rid of the dust nature. The lower nature. And then what happens? My eyes are open. I have the proper understanding. I know who I am in Christ. Salvation. See, the first time which he comes, he came to what? To bear the sins of the world, which is what Hebrews talks about. Which is what he did. The second time, what happens? Revelation. Salvation. Where is salvation? Inside of you and I. So Christ. And so the sneezing, listen, he breathed the dust into, he breathed into the nostrils, right? It says that the dust of the earth, right? And it says the dust is going back to the dust, right? And we usually recite that at funerals, like, you know, ash, right? But that's really not what that means. It means the dust nature is going back. He's going to get rid of the dust nature. I was just using that to mature you so that you realize this is about a star covenant. It's not about the dust covenant. I had to start you somewhere, folks. We'll start with the dust, then we'll go to the sand, but eventually we'll get into the stars. But I have to get rid of that now. What are you going to do? Well, I'm just going to force you to just blow it out. And when you sneeze, why do you sneeze? It's a protective mechanism for the body, right? Because it protects your breathing, your ability to breathe, so that you can have life. So when there's an obstruction, you sneeze, it gets rid of the obstruction. No different than you and I when we sneeze the seven times. We're just getting rid of the dust so that what? We can breathe, we can have life. And then what happens? Well, now my eyes are open. I have understanding, I have awareness. But I love that because that's essentially, again, what Hebrews does say. He says, as an appointment to men to once to die, Christ, the last Adam, he died. He died that death for us. And sometimes, you know what, that's hard to comprehend. That's what, for me, sometimes it is. And then I just say, okay, well, it's got to be real because you said so, Lord, and thank you. But he died our death for us. There is no more Adam. Really, we're just playing out. When we don't respond and live the life of Christ, and let's just say, you know, we stop measuring sand and or dust or whatever. That's really the hypocrite. That is the actor, because that's not who you truly are. Because if the last Adam was on Calvary, and it's really not if he was, then that Adam nature isn't real. It's just it just got replicated over the years, and then it just continues to play itself out until eventually, it's just Christ that's formed. And so what happens? We'll just keep sneezing. So it's actually not a bad thing, I guess, when you say God bless you when you sneeze. Now, we're not getting rid of demons, but we are getting rid of the dust next year. Amen?
God bless you.
Thank you. I'll take that. Psalms 34:8 is a pretty familiar passage, and it says, "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusts in him." And, you know, again, it's the same thing. It's what Once we do have this awareness, and we you know, again, the taste I just see is the discernment. When you truly understand the Word of God, this discernment that you tasted, then what happens? Well, you can see. You have clear understanding of what God is doing. And why? Because God is good. Even if you just left that alone and just lived on that, the Lord is good. Oh, taste and see. The Lord is good. And that's living in victory. You see, because then I can live each and every day. You can live each and every day of your life and realize it's just taste and see. The Lord is good. Really, he is. And so just because somebody else doesn't have that awareness yet doesn't mean the Lord isn't good. No, the Lord is good. But how are they going to know that? Well, I pray if they don't know it yet, through you, through me. Just like when Jonathan, he dipped the end of the rod into the honey. What happened? He tasted the honey. It said his countenance changed. Once the revelation of God is, you have this revelation and you realize that Christ is inside, it should change our countenance. It should change the way we look. Which is essentially, hopefully, how we just interact and live with one another. There should be the change. That's to just do it. That's to just do it. And so it does become real. That's apparent. You can see it. Because those that were around him knew there was a change. They just didn't know what. Or how? But they recognized the change they saw, because they said they saw that his countenance had changed. And that's what the revelation of Christ does to you and I. It changes our countenance. It changes our behavior. It changes essentially how we live our life. We just live in victory. Amen? Revelation 10, verse 9.
And I will turn to the angel and said unto him, give me the little book. And he said unto me, take it and eat it up, and it shall make thy belly bitter, but it shall be in thy mouth sweet as honey.
Yeah, sweet as honey. What little book do you think he's talking about? Let me get my little book. This is our little book right here. This is the little book he's talking about. Because what's happening, and what we have to see here, it's once we take the word of God in, right, it produces change. Where? In the belly. Now, that's what that essentially what that bitter is, because again, the natural man doesn't have the understanding. When I was natural and I thought natural and I look at this in a natural way, and I'm reading, okay, I gotta accept Christ or I burn in hell forever. If I don't do what God says and the rapture comes and splits the sky open, my mom and dad are gone, and my brothers and I we're all getting stuck behind, like, you know. But mom and dad are gone and we're stuck behind. See, it's bitter. And so how does that change over time? Once now I have the proper understanding, now that I can see, now that the Spirit of Christ is alive inside of me, it's no longer bitter. It produced change in me. It produces change in you. Now what happened? Well, now I can speak. I have the proper speech, and I can speak with honey. Revelation. No, nobody's going to hell. No, we're not waiting for the sky to split open. I just told you the day star is going to rise in your heart. It's the appearing of Christ in you. You see, now it's not bitter, but it did produce a change in me. It did produce a change in you. But now what? Well, now we can speak clearly. Now we have the proper understanding and the proper revelation. And guess what, honey? Yeah, I'll take some honey. I have no problem with the honey. And that's really what that is, and it just becomes our life. It becomes our testimony. When the Bible talks about the testimony, it's your life. It's not I got to declare something, and you know, I don't get on the street corner with a bullhorn and have to declare this thing. No, my testimony, it's just my life. It's just my life lived, amen? Amen. Revelation 15, verses 1 and 2.
And I saw another sign in heaven, great and marvelous, seven angels having seven last plagues. When them is to fill up the wrath of God. And I saw as it were the sea of glass mingled with fire. And them that had gotten the victory over the beast, and over his image, and over the mark, and over the number of his name, stand on the sea of glass, having the harps of God.
Amen. And of course, again, we are in Revelation 15 of this week as we're talking about victory over the beast, which is what this passage is speaking of. And there's several things in here. There's really just so much in Revelation 15, but just a few things that jumped out on me, you know, because it says here that that it is filled up. What's filled up? We're talking about the passion of God, the complete passion of God. It is filled up. I'm not waiting for it to be filled up. It says BD, it is filled up. I'm not waiting to get more of God. He's already filled you up. You already have all of God. When the Bible talks about, you know, the wrath of God, we're just talking about the passion of God. God's not man. God's not angry. We know that. But that's what he's saying there. It's the passion. And then we get victory over the beast. Again, we're just talking about our nature, this dust nature, this, you know, the lack of understanding in his image and over his mark and over the number of his name. The number, of course, we're talking about is 666. Now, where do we get 666? I don't know, but interestingly enough, the man was made on the sixth day, right? Nicole, you and I have talked about this. How many books are in the Bible? 66. It's the only way you can make a beast, like they talk about in Thessalonians. I usually take man, the sixth, the guy made on the sixth day, add those 66 books, and I just got 666. Because the person without the Bible, they don't create a beast. And the Thessalonians says he's in the church. Antichrist, Rome, the Mark, he's in the church. It's not the person without that doesn't know the word of God. If you go ask somebody, they didn't grow up in church, how many books in the Bible? You say, I don't know. Well, good, then you don't have the mark of a beast. Because you can't create all those things that you normally do over the course of your life when you have 66 books. Now I just add man to that, and I just create beast. I just create beast nature. I just create all of these things that we thought Revelation was talking about. Because I didn't have the proper understanding. Because the word hadn't yet matured. The seed hadn't yet matured. And so we thought it was everything, but there was no victory in it. Nobody was living in victory. The last thing we were living in victory, we were living in fear, dread, worry, doubt. What in the world is going to happen? Yeah, we're claiming victory. You'd be singing a song, you know, victory in Jesus. And then you go home, you'd be sweating it out, wondering what in the world's going to happen. There was no victory. But he's standing on a sea of glass. Now, how do you make glass?
Sand.
Fire and sand. That's all he did. So, what? Once again, I love God. We need the 50-pound dumbbells? Well, guess what? The sea and the dust and the sand, he just changed it. He didn't get rid of it. Fire, we talked about that. It produces change. It will change things. You put it in there, it'll change it. He just took the dust and the sand and he turned it into a sea glass. You now have absolute clarity. You see it for what it is. It was to get me to Mount Zion. It was to get me to the greater revelation. It was to birth the Spirit of Christ in me. I'm no longer confused about the dust and the sand. I'm no longer worried about the dust and the sand. No. He just put it through the fire, and now it's a sea of glass. It's just clear. I know what it is. You know what it is. There's no confusion. I'm standing on it. You're standing on it. Revelation 14:10. So this is in a few verses prior to 15:1 and 2. If somebody will read that. Yeah. So again, this one here, tormented, which we talked about before, it's a Greek word, basanos. It's just a testing. It's just a touching stone. He's basically trying and testing the overcomers. Us. You know, faith that's not tried is not real faith. Once it's tried, it's tested. No different than Jesus Christ. He said what? Hey, this is my son. And then what happened? You're going into the wilderness, Jesus. For what purpose? Not to be tempted, like to see if he's going to mess up. No, it's to be tried. The tempting, it's the trying, it's the testing, it's the same pattern that he shows you over and over. Once you realize you're a son, okay, now I'm ready to now try your faith. And that's exactly what Jesus Christ did. And of course, it was a beautiful picture, because what did he do? He overcame. Faith is trying. And that's what happens here. It's just a test. But I love it. You need two things now. You need fire and brimstone. Now, what is brimstone? Brimstone is actually sulfur. So I talked to one of my engineers yesterday in the plant. And I said, hey, you make glass. How do you make glass? He said, well, you need a real hot fire. He said, actually, it's almost 4,000 degrees. I said, wow, 4,000 degrees? He said, yep. He said, you need sand. He said, and then you need sulfur. You need brimstone. Can't make glass without sulfur. God is just so complete. Right, Mike? We talked about that. He doesn't leave any stone unturned, man. Again, the natural just represents the spiritual. So here you have the fire and the brimstone. We had this dust and the sand, and now I got my sea of glass. And the Bible talks about brimstone often, right? And again, you know, depends on how you've interpreted it over the years. It was usually not a good thing, but it really is obviously a good thing, because obviously it's God. We're talking about the presence of the Lamb, so it can't be a bad thing. If there's a Lamb involved here, it can't be bad. Amen? But it's just a testing, it's just a trying of our faith. And Peter talks about that, right? He says, don't think it's strange when these fiery trials come upon you. It's just to test your faith, man, that's all. But you're going to get through it. So you can lift the 120s, man. I don't want you to lift the 50, I don't want you to lift the 120s. Yeah, you know what I'm saying, Bill. Somebody, if you would, read for me Isaiah 30, verse 33. There you go. What's the brimstone? It's just the breath of God. That word breath is ruach. It's just the spirit of God. You had the Spirit of God to what? The passion of God. And guess what? He changes it. He changes it. And I love that. He says, who kindled this thing? Because we talked about the smoking, the flax, right? This flax that's just, you know, ever so dimly lit. I'm going to kindle this thing, guys. Don't worry about it. I'm just going to come along and just blow on this thing. I'm going to be the brimstone. I'm going to be the fire. I'm going to take care of it all. The brimstone. It's just the breath of the Lord. So how can we confuse the brimstone with anything else other than the life of God? Just the breath of God. Somebody read for me Isaiah 9 and 10, and then verse 31, if you would.
Except the Lord of hosts had left us unto a small remnant, we should have seen as with Sodom. We should have seen like unto Gomorrah. Hear the word of the Lord, you rulers of Sodom. Give ear unto the law of God, ye people of Gomorrah. The strong shall be as a toad, and the maker of it as a spark, and they shall both burn together, and none shall quench them.
Yeah. So this is essentially Isaiah 1, which I love Isaiah 1. It's really a beautiful passage. We've used some of the verses in the past. But once again, Sodom and Gomorrah, which we'll usually attribute to what, you know, just the slugs of the world, right? You know, the rotten, you know, no good folks. But he's saying right there, the rulers of Sodom, the people of Gomorrah, again, we're just talking about really those first two realms. It's just the dust and the sand. Because then he says where? At the end of this last verse in chapter 1, he says that he's going to burn both together. Both what? Sodom and Gomorrah. The dust and the sand. And I love that it says that because he says what? None shall quench them. The same thing that he says in Isaiah 42. The same thing that he says in Matthew 12. You can't put it out. You're not going to put it out because I'm going to change it. I'm going to make it like a sea of glass so you can stand upon it. So you'll see it for what it is. It was just those first two realms. It was just those first 2 days. But they both get changed. God changes Sodom and Gomorrah, glass. And you know, the interesting thing, as we know, remember now, what happened? Abraham obviously had to save Lot. Lot gets saved. Me, you, the body, the flesh, it is saved. Abraham is the spirit of Christ. It's not like God's doing away with our body. No, God's not doing away with our body. The wife, what happened? The wife looked back. The wife didn't make it out. The soul, it was changed. And why? Well, because you look back. You see, and that's what I thought of the verse where, you know, the plowman, when he looks back, he's not worthy of the kingdom. Why? Well, because I'm trying to find it in yesterday. And usually what happens when we look at yesterday? Well, either we're upset with something that happened, or I had something good and I lost it. And that's essentially what happens to the soul of man, because we're not letting go of yesterday. And you got to let go on yesterday. And because he says, you're plowing. And it's not because it's bad and wrong, but how can you plow a straight line if you're looking back? How can you see Christ if you're looking back? You can't. You can't. But look, I love this because I love the picture here where Abraham and Lot, they do come out. God is saving us. He is saving all of us. Every bit of us, the salvation, it's not just the spirit. Lot was saved too. And then he changed the soul because the soul's no longer in control. Our spirit is in control. We're not looking back. Nope. I'm plowing forward. You're plowing forward. It's just a picture. Come on, that's what this is now. It's just a picture. God's showing you, listen, this is the way. This is the way of walking in it. Just plow, go straight ahead. Don't look back at yesterday. Yeah, but yesterday, man, I had the boat and I had... Man, my 401k was pretty big, and you know, I had a lot of stuff, and I don't have it anymore. You know, I know. And Proverbs says, Lord, don't give me too little that I steal, or too much that I just forget about you. Which tells me, really, that no matter where we're at, whatever we have, you have enough. Because we don't steal, and we certainly don't ignore God. So I'm not looking back at yesterday. I'm not looking back at yesterday. You're not looking back at yesterday. Because then you won't see Christ. And Job said that also. I look for you behind me, Lord, and I look for you in front of me, Lord. Right, you're looking in the wrong place. It's now, it's today. You can't find him in yesterday. And none of us can find tomorrow. But you can experience him and see him today. The eternal God. He's today. He's ever present today. And that's what I see with that. But I love that. He just changed it. He just changed it. That's just so awesome. And then, of course, Matthew 12, 20. A bruised reed shall not break, and a smoking flax shall not quench, till he send forth judgment unto victory. His plan was for us to live in victory all the time. All the time, because it's the same verse that we find in Isaiah, that Isaiah prophesied. Listen, this thing is for you to live in victory. The only way you can live in victory today is when you recognize and realize the Spirit of Christ that's inside you and you're not moving back. And you realize that there's a seed in somebody else. And all you do is you help to bring that seed forth. You help to bring that Christ forth. That's living in victory. You see, and then I can say, listen, the 50s, those are easy, no problem. I can do the 120s. I can do the Sermon on the Mount. I can love my enemies. I can bless those that curse me. I can pray for those that speak poorly of me. You see, because the Bible says that it's got to be mercy and truth. Psalm talks about mercy and truth has met. Yeah, it just met. Once you realize Jesus Christ dwells inside of you, I need the truth. But it's always with mercy. It's always with love and understanding. And so if they don't have the understanding, it's mercy first. He says mercy and truth. God's a God of order. Mercy and truth. But apart from truth, you won't have it. And then what happens? He says, then righteousness has kissed peace. There's the intimacy. The intimacy comes from knowing our righteousness as a righteous one, as a Christ that's inside of us. And how could you not live in peace? You can live in peace. That's living in victory. Living in victory is having that awareness of Christ inside of you and living your life in peace, no matter the circumstances. You got to go with me a mile. No problem, I got peace. I'm going to go with you too. I'm going to sue you. Great. When? What do you need? I'm going to go. Peace. See, that's the peace that passes all human understanding. You can't manufacture that. You can try and sit in a quiet room and play a little Beethoven, have coffee or tea or whatever. You cannot manufacture that peace. It is impossible. But once you have the revelation that Christ dwells inside of you and the seed inside of every person all around you, and you have that awareness, and mercy meets truth, and righteousness kisses peace, victory. That's living a life of victory. But it's mercy and truth. Mercy and truth, amen? Amen. And then the last verse, if someone will read that.
For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith.
Yeah. Now, is there anything that's not born of God? Everything is born of God. Nothing exists without God, which means everybody. Everybody. And I love that. And what is the victory? It's just overcoming the worldly thinking, the worldly understanding. Because again, it's not about that. We just said it's about the star covenant. You want to overcome? And the Bible, and Revelation does say what? They overcame by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. When I realize that the blood of the Lamb, the Spirit of Christ that flows within my veins, that flows within your veins, think about that for a second now. The Spirit of God is flowing through your veins tonight, right now. Amen. Thank you, Brother Gail. You can overcome. And by the word of their testimony, it's just my life. It's just your life. That's victory. That's victory. You have it right now, today. And God just is, I believe that He's just blowing on us. It's that passion, and then he's just blowing on us. He kindles it. He changes it all. He just changes it all. And what's he changing? It's just our understanding, our awareness. Which ultimately then just changes us. And we realize, and I just think of that the passage with Christ when he talks to James and John. You know not what manner of spirit you are. He didn't even call him that. You just don't realize the spirit that dwells inside of you. That's powerful. Amen? I'm going to ask my brother if he'll give us a few closing comments and then maybe close us out with a prayer. You want my brother? Yeah.
Hey, okay, you all awake?
Yeah.
Wow. That was a wow.
Amen.
Oh my goodness. Jews. You know, it's amazing when the Word of God is opened up. I don't need to verify a bunch of things to know that that's true. I hear it. I know that's true. I know it. It shuts our minds down, you know? And, you know, so many times when you hear something like that, you know, Phil, you're like a machine gun today. Pop, 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 pop. See, the nice thing is this. I don't have to remember it all. I don't even have to write it all down. I am changed by the spoken word of God. Just by sitting here, we're changed. That word has become a part of us. Because that's how God works. He says he does it through the foolishness of preaching. And that's just amazing. I'm amazed at what God... Aren't you amazed at what God gives us in this house? Yeah. Very powerful. Very powerful. You know, the opening that Pastor Phil gave us was just do it and teach it. And there's so much beauty in that. You know, how are we going to save the world? Just live this life that we know to live. We don't have to be concerned about teaching a part of it, but just live the life, you know? Why don't you all stand and close with a word of prayer. Very powerful. Thank you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Lord, you're so faithful to us. You're so good to us, and you love us. You love us, Lord, so deeply, and as Pastor Phil said, so passionately. And tonight, my Lord, Heavenly Father, we are overcome and overwhelmed by your love, by the beauty of your words, and the blessing of it all, Lord. Thank you for your word tonight, Lord. And even as, you know, we are preparing for the new year, we're here because, Lord, we seek your face for the year 2014. We seek your face that you would show us your will and your ways, that you'd open up to us an understanding of heaven. And here it is in front of us. Lord, before the year has come, you've already answered our prayer. We thank you, Lord, for your goodness and your faithfulness to us, Lord Jesus. My Lord, we're overwhelmed by your word and we are changed by it forever. And all that we're going to do is go and live this life that you've called us to live. And it's going to be done by the word of God that's caused to jump and leap and arise within our hearts, Lord Jesus. So as we leave here this night, we leave in victory. We leave with victory. The victory that has always been ours. But tonight I believe it has risen from within us. I believe a day star has arose. And my God, may the world see and know the victory that is ours because of your passion for us all. It's in the mighty, powerful, matchless name of our Lord Jesus we pray and everybody says,
Amen.
Amen. God bless you all. Amen. Enjoy your stay, everybody.